Hello everyone, I am Neeru from Pinnacle Coaching Center, and today we are going to do SSC CGL Tier 1 paper. The paper code is 878. Pinnacle is offering 3-4 types of test series. In these, we are going to cover 50 computer-based tests according to the new pattern given by SSC, from paper code 851 to paper code 900. And for each and every question which is going to be done in these test series, there's a video explanation. So this is the video explanation for paper 878 and the general awareness section. Some of our videos are going to be in the public domain, but others are going to be available only for those who have joined our test series. So if you wish to be a part of our test series by Pinnacle, you can visit our website ssccglpinnacle.com. Visit our website, and over there you will find that 3-4 kinds of test series are being offered. One is with video explanation, one is without video explanation. Then there are test series for Tier 2, Tier 1 and Tier 2 in combination. Whichever you feel is suitable for yourself, you can join that. So now let's begin. Paper code 878, the general awareness section. Belgrade is located on the bank of the river Dash. Question from geography. This is from world geography. Belgrade is located on the bank of which river? Options. Options are Danube, Spree, Rhine and Yangon. And answer is Danube. Belgrade is the capital and the largest city of Serbia. It is located at the confluence of two rivers, Sava and Danube River, where the Pannonian Plains meet the Balkans. There's a Balkan Peninsula there. Okay, so question number 26, answer is A, Danube. Which of the following is a kharif crop? There are three cropping seasons in India. One is the Rabi, next is the kharif, and the third is, in between these two, there's another third one known as Zaid. Rabi crops sown in the beginning of winter season and harvested in the beginning of the summer season. Then kharif crops sown in the beginning of the monsoon and harvested sometime at the end of September or October. Zaid, in this season, seasonal vegetables are grown. This is sometime in the summers. So which of the following is a kharif crop? Barley, oilseeds, gram and cotton. Kharif crops are usually sown in the beginning of the first rains in July during the southwest monsoon season, and common kharif crops are cotton, rice, millet, maize, pea and peanut. So question number 27, here which of the following is a kharif crop? Cotton is a kharif crop. Cotton is a kharif crop. So question number 27, answer is D from Indian geography. Where is the Campbell National Park located? Where is the Campbell National Park located? Lakshadweep Islands, Andaman Nicobar Islands, Pondicherry or Meghalaya? These are my four options. Question from geography again, Indian geography. Campbell Bay National Park, this is the national park in India, located on the island of Great Nicobar. It's located in Great Nicobar Islands. It was gazetted as a national park in India in the year 1992, and it is a part of the Great Nicobar Biosphere Reserve. So Campbell National Park, where is it located? It's located in the Great Nicobar. Question number 28, answer is B. 28, answer is B. Let's move on to the next question. Which of the following is incorrect? My question is, which of the following is incorrect? So we have four options now, 1, 2, 3 and 4. And out of these options, 3 are going to be correct and 1 is going to be incorrect. And we have to find out which one is incorrect. Let's take a look. The largest producer of tobacco in India is Andhra Pradesh. Largest producer of bananas in India is Tamil Nadu. Largest producer of wheat in India is Punjab. And the largest producer of black pepper in India is Kerala. Okay, these are my options. Now, tobacco, it was introduced by the Portuguese in India, and the largest producer of tobacco is Andhra Pradesh. This is absolutely right. The largest producer of bananas is in India is Tamil Nadu. This is also correct. The largest producer of wheat in India is Punjab. This is incorrect. The largest producer of wheat is Uttar Pradesh, but if you see in terms of yield per hectare, then Punjab, it is better than UP. Its performance is better than UP. So, but we are talking about the largest producer of wheat. We are not talking about yield per hectare. So, this is incorrect. Largest producer of black pepper in India is Kerala. This is absolutely right. And pepper has always been, since ancient times, one of our chief items that we send to other countries also. During the Vijayanagar Empire, this was the main item for export. So now let's take a look. So out of these four options, question number 29, C was incorrect. Now let's look at the explanation. Wheat is the main cereal crop in India, and Uttar Pradesh or UP is the leading producer of in wheat production. And it leads with more than 30% of the 30% share of total wheat production in India. And Punjab is another leading wheat producing state in India, and it is number 2. It is number 2, but if you talk in terms of yield per hectare, and this data is of 2016, and if you talk in terms of yield per hectare, then Punjab is definitely performing better than UP. So question number 29, answer is C. Question number 30, also from geography. Which state has the highest number of ports in India? Which state has the highest number of ports in India? We are talking. Recently, there was a question, which state has the highest number of airports? The highest number of airports are in Gujarat. But we are talking here in terms of which state has the largest number of ports. Maharashtra, Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. We have a long coastline. We have a long coastline. So there will definitely be a number of ports. Maharashtra. The two major ports of Maharashtra are the Navasheva port and the Mumbai port. Apart from that, Maharashtra has 53 ports. It has higher number of ports in, it has the highest number of ports. Maharashtra is going to be number 1. Maharashtra is followed by Gujarat, which is number 2. Kandla port is in Gujarat, known as the offspring of partition. And then we have Andhra Pradesh port, Andhra Pradesh on the third position. So the highest number of ports in India are in Maharashtra. They are in Maharashtra. Maharashtra is number 1. Question number 31. Let's take a look at question number 31. The 8th schedule of the constitution contains how many national languages? So far we did questions of geography. Now let's do a question of polity, Indian polity. If you wish to do well in the GS section, your geography, your history, your polity, economics, current events, everything is going to be covered under this. And the higher level of exam you give, the better your grip should be over general awareness. Tomorrow, if you wish to appear for state civil services or for central civil services exam, then definitely your GA will play a major role there. The 8th schedule of the constitution contains how many national languages? The national languages are contained in the 8th schedule. 8th schedule of the constitution of India, it lists the official languages of the Republic of India. And right now there are 22 languages. From time to time new languages have been added. So for question number 31, answer is D, 22. Which languages are these? These are Assamese, Bengali, Bodo, Dogri, Gujarati, Hindi, Kannada, Kashmiri, Konkani, Maithili, Malayalam, Manipuri, Marathi, Nepali, Odia, Punjabi, Sanskrit, Santhali, Sindhi, Tamil, Telugu and Urdu. These are the official languages. You could be given a question as to the official languages of the Republic of India are contained in which schedule. You must know the answer. It's the 8th schedule. The 8th schedule contains how many official languages for the Republic of India? The answer is 22. And which of the following is not an official language mentioned in the 8th schedule? You should know that also. So question number 31, answer is D. Next question, question number 32. Arrange the following states in the order in which they were formed. In the order we became free, and after that there was the State Reorganization Act and many new states were formed. Now my options are Manipur, Sikkim, Mizoram and Goa. And we have to arrange them in the chronological order, beginning with the one that was formed the earliest. Let's take a look at the explanation and then we shall come back to the question. Here is the explanation. 1953 first linguistic state Andhra Pradesh. Okay, Andhra Pradesh, this was created in the year 1956. The State Reorganization Act was passed, and then on the basis of languages we organized as states. Andhra Pradesh, first state to be organized on the basis of language in the year 1956. 1960, prior to the formation of Maharashtra and Gujarat, we had one huge area there known as Bombay. Bombay was the province there, and then it was bifurcated into two, Gujarati speaking people, the area known as Gujarat, and the Marathi speaking people area known as the Maharashtra. This happened in the year 1960. 1962, Nagaland was formed. 1966, then there were Haryana was created out of Punjab. The state of Punjab was split into state of Punjab and state of Haryana and Union Territory of Chandigarh. And Chandigarh became the capital of both. 69, Meghalaya was made a sub-state within Assam. Then we have Himachal Pradesh was upgraded from Union Territory to a state. 71, Manipur, Tripura, Meghalaya, they were given the status of states, and Mizoram and Arunachal Pradesh, they were made Union Territories. But now they are states. 1975, Sikkim was admitted as the 22nd state. 86, Mizoram and Arunachal Pradesh, which were earlier Union Territories, now they became full-fledged states in the year 1986. 1987, Goa became the 25th and the smallest state. It has only two districts. Then 2000, Chhattisgarh, Uttarachal and Jharkhand were created. Chhattisgarh in MP, Uttarachal, earlier Uttarachal, later named as Uttarakhand, was created out of Uttar Pradesh, and Jharkhand was created out of Bihar. These were all formed in the year 2000, and the latest state to be formed is Telangana. So this is given to you so that you get an idea as to when which state was created. And now let's go back to our question. We have been asked when Manipur, Sikkim, Mizoram and Goa were created. Let's take a look at the years. Here we have Manipur. Where do we have Manipur? The state of Manipur. Let's take a look. Manipur is in the year 1971. Goa is in the year 1987. Then we have Sikkim also. Sikkim is in 1975. And which was the other one? The other one was Mizoram. When was Mizoram created? Mizoram is also here only. So question number 32, my answer is going to be, first was Manipur to be created, then Sikkim, then Mizoram, and then finally Goa. This is the answer. Answer is B for question number 32. Goa was the last to be created. That was a question of polity. Now let's move on to the next one. The term fourth estate, it refers to the press and media. Who used it for the first time? This is the fourth estate. There are three pillars. The three pillars are legislative, executive and judiciary. And what is the fourth pillar? The fourth pillar is known as the press. And press is also known as the fourth estate. The press has a very responsible role to play in the society. Now, who had used this term fourth estate for the first time? Answer is Edmund Burke, B-U-R-K-E. Now, who is he? In England, the three classes shared power in government and they were called three estates. Lord Spiritual, Lord Temporal and Commons. Eventually, with growing influence of press in public affairs, it was recognized as the fourth estate. And Edmund Burke used it for the first time in a parliamentary debate in 1787 on the opening of the press reporting of the House of Commons. So, question number 33, answer is A. Question number 34, which of the following is not a fundamental duty? Which of the following is not a fundamental duty? This is my question. To pay taxes on time, to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do so. This is a question from polity. Okay. To develop scientific temper, humanism and the spirit of inquire and reform. And the last one is to safeguard public property and to abjure violence. And to abjure violence, give up violence. Out of these four options, my answer is going to be A, to pay taxes on time. To pay taxes on time is not a fundamental duty. All the other three are fundamental duties which the government of India expects the citizens to do. Question number 34, let us study a few important things about fundamental duties. Firstly, it was the Swarna Singh Committee who suggested to incorporate fundamental duties in our constitution. When the constitution was framed, there was nothing mentioned about fundamental duties. But by the 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act in the year 1976, these fundamental duties were incorporated. Which committee? Swarna Singh Committee. Which amendment? 42nd Amendment. And which year? Year is 1976. Remember all three. And at that time, the Congress government was in power and the Swarna Singh Committee, known as Sardar Swarna Singh Committee, they had made the recommendation for these fundamental duties, and it had even suggested that paying of taxes should be made a fundamental duty of the citizens, but it was not accepted by the ruling party then. Certain recommendations of the committee were not accepted by the Congress party and hence not incorporated. The duty to pay taxes was not accepted as a fundamental duty of the citizens. It was not accepted as a fundamental duty of the citizens. Question number 34, answer is A. Question number 35, let's take a look. Reducing the amount of sentence without changing its character is known as, okay, simply somebody has been given 10 years of imprisonment. We are reducing that to suppose say 7 years. Reducing the amount of sentence without changing its character. Character will be changed. Suppose somebody has been given rigorous imprisonment and we change it to simple imprisonment. This is changing the character. But here, reducing the amount of sentence without changing its character is known as what? It's respite, reprieve, then we have commutation and remission. These are all powers given to the president and the governor under their judicial power. If you read any book on polity, you will find these, okay, these terms mentioned. Now, what do these terms exactly mean? This is another question from polity. See, in pardon, we are completely absolving the offender and he is being set free now. Pardon. Okay. In reprieve, R-E-P-R-I-E-V, there is temporary suspension of the sentence. Temporary suspension. In respite, we have SP in the middle. SP meaning special. Okay. We are awarding a lesser sentence on special grounds. Special grounds could be something like a woman is expecting, she's pregnant. So that is the reason. Suppose she has been given death sentence and we are now going to award a lesser sentence because of her pregnancy. That's due to a special ground. That's respite. Then we have remission. In remission, we reduce the amount of sentence without changing its character. 10 years has been changed to 7 years. 7 years has been changed to 3 years. So for 35, question number 35, my answer is going to be remission D. There is another one, another term here, commutation. Let's understand that also. Commutation is substitution of one form of punishment for another form which is of lighter character. Lighter character. Suppose somebody has been given rigorous imprisonment. Now we are giving him simple imprisonment. This is it. So question number 35, answer is going to be D. Question number 36, who freed the press of restrictions in 1835? It was Charles Metcalfe. Charles Metcalfe, he repealed the obnoxious 1923 ordinance and we gave him the name of liberator of the Indian press. You could be given a question as to who is known as the liberator of the Indian press. It's Charles Metcalfe, and he adopted a liberal press policy for the rapid growth of newspapers. That's the reason we call him the liberator of the Indian press. Question from Indian National Movement, or you can say modern India. Question number 36. Next is question number 37. He advocated a new style of teaching Sanskrit and opened the gates of Sanskrit college to non-Brahmins. Now, from the very ancient times, we have seen that the Sanskrit language has been the monopoly of the Brahmanas. It has been the monopoly of the Brahmanas, but during the time of socio-religious awakenings in India, it was these lines refer to Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. It was Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar who advocated a new style of teaching Sanskrit, and he wanted the people to read our religious books and texts themselves so that they could understand what has been mentioned in them and not depend upon the mere translation and interpretation of the Brahmanas. So he opened numerous schools. He was associated to Bithune schools, and he was a strong advocate for widow remarriage also. And it was due to his efforts that the first widow remarriage took place in Bengal. So he advocated a new style of teaching Sanskrit and opened the gates of Sanskrit college to non-Brahmins. Who is he? To whom are these lines referred? Devendranath Tagore, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, Surendranath Banerjee or Jyotiba Phule? These lines are referred to Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. In fact, his real name is Ishwar Chandra Bandopadhyay. Ishwarchandra Bandyopadhyay, and he was a moderate reformer, but he had great love for education. He did so much for education that with love the people of Bengal gave him the title Vidya Sagar. Vidya meaning education, knowledge. Ishwarchandra Bandyopadhyay, he was a moderate reformer. The Bengal Renaissance took a shape due to his stirring and integrated personality, and he strongly advocated teacher training and established 5 normal schools in Calcutta. And he opened the gates of Sanskrit College for non-Brahmin boys. So question number 37, my answer is going to be B. Please remember, he is remembered for 2 things. Firstly, he is remembered for opening the gates of Sanskrit colleges to non-Brahmins, and secondly, Widow Remarriage Act. Widow Remarriage was act, act was passed in due to his efforts. Question number 37. Question number 38. Who among the following did not support the revolt? It was modern educated Indians, Zamindars, landlords and money lenders, Raja of Jodhpur or Nawab of Bengal. All of them did not support the revolt. The modern educated Indians thought that if the British thought and believed that whatever the Britishers were doing, it was for the welfare of India. They would modernize India because they themselves came from a modern country. And if the Britishers went away from here, then India would go backwards. So that is the reason that modern educated Indians did not support it. Zamindar, landlords and money lenders felt that their own interest lay in the fact that Britishers continued to stay in India. So they did not support it. And Raja of Jodhpur and the Nawab of Bengal, neither did they support the revolt. So question number 38, answer is A. Question number 39, who founded the Widow Remarriage Association in the 1850s? Who founded the Widow Remarriage Association in 1850s? Jyotiba Phule, Vishnu Shastri Pandit, Gopal Hari Deshmukh or none? Question number 39, answer is B, is Vishnu Shastri Pandit. He founded the Widow Remarriage Association in the 1850s. That's the answer. Question number 40, Indian National Movement. Nehru Report did not demand which of the following for India? What did the Nehru Report not demand for India? That is my question. Nehru Report. It was Motilal Nehru, under the leadership of Motilal Nehru, that the Nehru Report was presented. And it's quite important, you must know about it, that when Simon Commission came to India, the Indians boycotted it, saying that you have not included any Indian in it. And after that, it was Lord Linlithgow who challenged the Indians to frame a constitution by the consensus of all political parties in India. And then as a reply to him, the Nehru Report was framed. It was the first effort by Indians to frame the constitution for India. But however, everybody's consensus on this report was not attained. Now, Nehru Report did not demand which of the following? It demanded linguistic provinces, it demanded a secular state, it demanded 19 fundamental rights, but it did not demand complete independence for India. And since Motilal Nehru's report, he was the man behind it. Since it did not demand complete independence for India, Motilal Nehru's own son Jawaharlal Nehru, he opposed it. Because the Nehru report had asked for dominion status, and the younger section of the Congress was demanding that let's demand complete independence and not dominion status. So Nehru report did not demand complete independence for India. Question number 40, answer is A. 41, from medieval India. Question from medieval India. Who was called Prince among Maniyas? Who was called Prince among Maniyas? Question number, this is 41. Alauddin Khilji, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Jalaluddin Khilji or none? Who has been called Prince among Maniyas? This was question number 41. Answer is B. It's Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he carried out monetary experiments and he's called Prince among Maniyas. In 1329-30, he ordered vast quantities of lead coins to be made with the same value as silver coins. The silver coin was known as Tanka. and the idea failed miserably because he did not do anything to curb its private and unauthorized issue, and every house became a mint. Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he was the most educated among the rulers who ruled in the Sultanate period, but he was known as a mixture of opposites because many of his experiments failed. Question number 41, answer is B, Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Question number 42, consider the following statements about Pisces fishes, which of them is correct? And now we have moved on to science. This is a question from science. Fishes are cold-blooded, absolutely right. Their hearts have only four chambers like humans have, this is incorrect. Fishes lay eggs, yes, they are absolutely right. They use gills to obtain oxygen dissolved in water, this is also absolutely right. Question number 42, the option given as B is incorrect. 43, most common skin infections are caused by bacteria, fungi, worms or virus. Most common skin infections, dermatology. Okay, dermatology is the study about skin. Most common skin infections are caused by fungi. Fungi diseases are called mycosis, and those affecting humans can be divided into four groups based on the level of penetration into the body tissues. Question number 43 is B. Next is question number 44. The flexibility in plants is due to a permanent tissue. And what is this permanent tissue called? Flexibility of plants is called parenchyma, chlorenchyma, erenchyma or colenchyma. Now we need to understand what is parenchyma, chlorenchyma, erenchyma and colenchyma. Let's understand that. Question number 44. This is question number 44. My answer is D, colenchyma first. What is colenchyma? Colenchyma is found in plants. It provides extra structural support, especially in regions of new growth. This is its function. Colenchyma tissue is composed of elongated cells with irregularly thickened walls, and they provide structural support in growing shoots and leaves. Colenchyma tissue make up things such as the resilient strands on stalks of clary, and they are usually living and have only a thick primary wall made up of cellulose and pectin. So this is responsible for flexibility in plants. Then we have sclerenchyma, it provides the main structural support. Parenchyma is the filler tissue in soft parts of the plants, and erenchyma, this is a spongy tissue that forms spaces on air channels in the leaves, stems and roots of some plants. Question number 44, answer is D. 45, from physics, a microphone converts what kind of energy into what kind of energy? It converts sound waves to electrical signals. Microphone, when you're going to speak, that's it. Microphone. Question number 45. Other options are electrical signals to sound waves to kinetic energy, or sound waves to mechanical energy. Kinetic energy is moving energy, mechanical energy is stored energy. So these two get eliminated. We are left with only A and B. Microphones are a type of transducer, a device which converts energy from one form to another, and microphone converts sound waves into electrical energy, audio signals. Question number 45, answer is A. 45 is A. Which part of the eye contains several nerve cells? Which part of the eye contains several nerve cells? It's the iris, it's the retina, it's the pupil or it's the aperture. Question number 46 is B, retina. Retina is the third and inner coat of the eye, which is a light sensitive layer. The optics of the eye create an image of the visual world on the retina through the cornea and lens, which serve much the same function as the film in a camera. A camera is quite compared to an eye, and there are many similarities. The iris, it is responsible for controlling the diameter and size of the pupil and thus the amount of light reaching the retina, and the color of the eye depends on the iris and pupil. Pupil is a hole located in the center and iris of the eye that allows light to strike the retina. Question number 46, B. Next is question number 47. Speed of sound will be fastest in aluminium, steel, glass or water. Out of these four options, Speed of sound will be fastest in aluminium. It is 6320 meters per second. This is the answer. Question number 47. Answer is A, aluminium. Next question from economics. The data collected for national income estimation is conducted in India by who? The answer is NSSO. And what is NSSO? It's National Sample Survey Organization. National Sample Survey Organization, they collect the data for national income estimation. Answer is C, 48C. Question number 49. The addition made to the total cost when the production of a good is increased by one unit is? It is known as marginal cost. The change in total cost resulting from a small change in output, that is known as marginal cost. Since by definition only variable costs may change, marginal fixed cost must be zero and the rate of change of variable cost determines the marginal cost of production. 49 is B. Next question number 50. From the national point of view, which of the following indicates micro approach? Per capita income of India, study of sales of DISCO, inflation in India, or educated unemployment in India. Now, firstly, let us understand what is micro approach and what is macro approach. Let's understand those two. Pretty simple question from economics, the last question to be done. Now, microeconomics, it's a branch of economics which studies the behavior of individuals and firms in making decisions regarding allocation of limited resources at a small level. Typically, it applies to market where goods or services are bought and sold. In contrast, in macroeconomics, it involves sum total of economic activity dealing with issues of growth, inflation, unemployment at a larger level. So, study of sales in TISCO, larger level inflation in India, study of unemployment in India, per capita income, all these three are related to the macro approach. But study of sales in TISCO, this is related. TISCO is Tata Iron and Steel Company. It's a company which produces steel. This is going to be the micro approach. So question number 50, answer is going to be B. And that was the last question to be done. I wish you all the very, very best. For all those students who wish to join our test series so that they can watch each and every video that we are making, because we are giving you 50 tests from paper code 851 to paper code 900, and for each and every question there is going to be a supporting video explanation, because that will make things and concepts much, much clearer to you. If you wish to join our test series, then you can visit our website sscclpinnacle.com. And over there, there are complete details about the various test series that we are offering. You can join. I wish you all the very, very best. Thank you for watching my video. Bye-bye.